So in the last lecture, you are told about the nature of torque, the torque that is developed in different machines from a general expression for torque. That is an interaction between the stator and rotor magnetic fields, and therefore in a DC machine, you get one expression for torque which is proportional to the flux and the armature current. And in a synchronous machine, we get an expression for torque which is equal to the resultant flux into the field excitation into the sine of the angle between the two. Then same thing is with induction machines. Okay, so we get a picture of how the torque in three machines are developed and how they vary. Okay, so today let us discuss about using the voltage and the torque expressions of DC machines and knowing the other characteristics of the construction and other features. Let us complete the all the basic or important aspects of DC machine which all engineers are expected to know, irrespective of whatever is the discipline. Okay, therefore, so this is what I have tried to put you in a capsule. You are aware of the field excitation in DC machines, how the field is excited, that is the stator structure, and you are aware there are different. One is either you can put a permanent magnet. See, you can put a permanent magnet on the stator, which means you have no control on the flux. So it's almost a nearly constant flux system. You can't control the flux. Then you can have a next would be you have a shunt or separately excited system. Okay, either separately excited or shunt excited, and they are mostly they are all voltage dependent. You have a second system where your excitation current is voltage dependent, that is across the armature voltage. Whatever is armature voltage that comes across the center. So that means this is also nearly constant flux because most of the machines operate at a near constant voltage. Okay, voltage constancy is there. So you also find that means, but this excitation is controllable. The shunt are separately excited, you can control the field excitation, the flux is controllable. But you can also maintain it constant. Okay, please. Now let us look at the other one. It is called a series excitation, where the field winding is in series with the armature winding, which means the flux is proportional to load or the current. Right? So here is a situation where the flux of a machine, it depends upon the load or the armature current. Okay? So it is not a constant flux system. Then you have a combination which you call it as compound machines. Okay, so you have the compound machines where you either have a differentially compound machine and a cumulatively compound machine. In fact, it can be shown like this better, where you have both series and shunt windings like this. So I have schematically shown, supposing this is the pole on which both the series winding and shunt windings are wound. S is the series winding and F is the main field or shunt winding. Okay, now they are wound in such a way that whenever you pass a current here and a current here, it will aid the flux. Okay, so you can pass a current through, say, let's say this is one in the shunt winding and field. So it will, whatever flux the shunt field will give and whatever the flux the series field will give, they will aid. Okay, and if that is the connection, it is called a cumulatively compound. That means it is compounded cumulatively. That means shunt and series fields aid each other. Means the flux, total flux is proportional to NFIF plus NSIS. That is MMF produced by the main field winding and MMF produced by the series field winding. Is it clear? And in fact, it can be easily seen that shunt field winding has larger turns and thinner wires. Series field winding will have thicker wires and smaller turns. Yeah? And lower resistance is higher resistance. We have discussed in some other earlier lectures also. Now, whereas differentially compound means you reverse the connection here. Differentially compound means that the series excitation will oppose the main field excitation. That is called a differentially compound system. Okay? So, differentially compound system will have the series excitation NSIS, NFIF. So, it will be NFIF minus NSIS. Is it clear? So, you have the fluxes in differentially compound is a difference between the main field MMF and series field MMF. And in a cumulative compound, the flux is proportional to the sum of the shunt field MMF and series field MMF. Is it clear? Okay. And it is how it can be done. Now, if something is a motor, you will see there will be a cumulatively compound, it will generate a differentially compound, because while the shunt field may have the same direction, series field will have an opposite direction. Okay. Now, so let us, when we look at the characteristics, we should look at the characteristics of each of these systems. That's what it is. So, as a generator, how the characteristic will be for different systems. As a motor, how the characteristic will be different excitation. Okay. Now, if you look at the generator, this is the, let's say, connection of a generator. But I'll try to get copies of this so that you can refer to it. I made a general connection of a generator. Okay, first let us look at the connection. Since it is a generator, it is power is going out of a energy flow is like this. From a prime mover, you are putting in a torque. Okay, you are putting in a torque which is driving the rotor. That means in the same direction which you are putting in torque, same direction the speed will be there. But as a reaction of the field, the electric torque of the generator will be opposing the input torque to be in equilibrium. In a steady condition, you can say the input torque should be equal to the opposing torque, reaction torque. Except for us, maybe you can, if there is some friction torque, that can be added as input plus friction. And if it is running at a fixed speed, there are no accelerating torques. There are no inertial torques. Okay. Now, that means you now drive the armature. And due to the excitation or the flux, there is a voltage that is generated EA. Isn't it? Because of the excitation. And the excitation, I have made it as a general thing. It's all self-excited. You can also have a separate excitation also, which is given by a separate one. So, then the EA will be directly proportional to the speed and the excitation flux. Okay. So, the flux is provided. It will be in this direction. By the flux is provided by the main field winding and the series field winding together. Now, the series field winding is in series with the armature and the shunt field winding is across the armature. But this is, you can either connect this shunt field just across here or across here. I mean, there is a subtle differences. This is called a long shunt connection. Long shunt because it is shunted across both the armature and the series. If you just connect this across the armature, it is called a short shunt connection. There is a long shunt and a short shunt connection. And now, and the current as a generator, it comes out. This is the armature current, and then this is the field current, and this is the load current, which is feeding to a load. This is the load system. You are feeding to a load, and across the load, there is a voltage across. This is VL. That VL across the load will, of course, oppose the EA that is generated. Okay, so there is an electrical balance here and there is a mechanical balance here. Okay, and the expressions you already know for this, that T torque developed is equal to Ka into phi into Ia, where phi is the flux produced due to all the excitation together, and voltage is Ea, that means we know the torque Te and we know Ea, which is a constant into phi into speed. Right? These are the two electrical energy conversion expressions, developed torque and speed. Now, we have already seen mechanical balance equation, where this torque is equal to input torque plus any friction, which fatality is any. And the electrical balance equation will be that VL is equal to Ea minus Ia into drop in this, that is the isolated internal resistance plus the resistance of the series field. So Ia into Ra plus R series, that is the VL, and the IF will be whatever is the VL divided by its own resistance of the field winding. Okay, that is the field current. The current that goes out of the load will be the current here, IL minus IF. Okay, so this is the these are the governing equations. Yeah, but we are looking at a DC system. Right? It is a DC. Is it clear? That this is the network, these are the equations. I'll get this copied and make it available to you. Okay? Now, on the contrary, if you have a motor connection, this is a system that looks like a DC motor. A DC motor, now energy flow is now from the electrical side to the mechanical side, a DC motor. From here it is. So you are putting in a voltage. Again, I have made it to be as self-excited. So these are the main field and this is a series field. And series field is, of course, in series with the armature, and main field across the armature. In this case, it is across the armature plus series field. So when you apply a voltage V, here, then there is a current, input current from the mains or the supply, IL. Now, out of which certain portion of the current goes into the field winding, and remaining goes into the series, which is also same as the armature. So this is the series field current. Is the armature current. Okay? And then whatever is remaining will be Ea. Now, same equations hold good here. Same torque equation, Te is equal to Ka phi Ia and Ea is equal to Ka phi omega m. Right? Now, as a motor generator, you would expect the power flow should be reversed so that Te will be opposite to what it was earlier because your current direction has reversed for the same flux direction. So whatever was a motor and when it becomes a generator, the main difference you will find is the current direction changes and the torque direction changes and speed direction is same and voltage direction is same. If it changes both, then the power is, there is no change. Mechanical power is torque into speed, electrical power is voltage into current. You can't change both voltage and current and say I have made a change. You should change only one. So, usually voltage is same direction and current is reverses. Because of that, speed is same direction and torque is reverses. Okay, here torque has reversed. Now, this is the output torque. This is the electrical torque, that is Te, and which causes the speed omega m. This Te is opposed by the external load torque, TL. TL is the load which you are connecting. For example, a fan, the blades are the loads. So, in a pump, the impellers are the loads. So, in anything, there is a mechanical load. Like electrical loads, you have resistors or motors, they become the load. Okay. Now, the governing equations, you can easily write from this. It is not difficult. Okay. Governing equation, Ea is equal to V minus Ia into the Ra plus Rc. So, that is Ea is equal to whatever the voltage minus the drop across the series resistance and the armature resistance. then the field current is given by whatever is the voltage here divided by RF. That is clear? So this is the current across the field winding. Of course, you can connect external field also. Okay. Then the current here will therefore be IL minus the IF. Okay. So this is the governing equation. Yes.
The stator and the rotor part of
the thing. This is stator, this is rotor. All are there. Nothing is missed. Okay? Yeah, in both cases we have made it separate, but it can be separately excited also. Separately means you just take out the terminals and keep it separately. That's all. Okay? Okay. Now, let us look at the characteristic of a generator. What are the characteristics of a generator? Now, usually there are two characteristics. One is called the open circuit characteristics, OCC. OCC means open circuit characteristics. That means how the voltage across the generator will change with the excitation or field current. Okay? And we can show that EI is proportional to flux, isn't it, for a given speed. So EI and phi are same on the y-axis, and the independent variable is the field current, right? If it is a permanent magnet machine, your EI is always proportional to the speed because it is a constant flux system. Therefore, since EI is proportional to speed, as IF increases, you would expect it will go like this, and since phi IF relation is not always linear, it is like BH. This is proportional to B, this is proportional to H. Therefore, you will find non-linearity, and this will be for omega M1 speed, this is omega M2 speed. Omega M2 is less than omega M1. Okay? For different speed, you get a family of characteristics of voltage generated versus the field current. And the there is always a residue here, okay? And you can also, if it is a self-excited shunt generator, we can say that the voltage across the shunt field will have some curve like this. This is I into RF. That means you have a curve which is the current into voltage across the shunt field. So, after all, voltage across the shunt field must be same as the voltage generated. It is the same, you know, across the shunt field. So, obviously, the resistance of the shunt field winding becomes critical. See, you want initially certain voltage must be there because of residue. But because of residue, a certain small voltage must be there, and because of the small voltage, certain field current will flow through. And because that field current will cause a flux, which will cause a voltage, and that voltage will cause again a current. So it is a avalanche effect. So it just, you need some initial excitation. So it builds up and finally it comes to a steady condition like this. Okay? And this is the steady operating voltage for a given field current RF. Now if you change RF, if you increase RF, what will happen? The curve will shift to the left or right? Huh? No, curve will shift to the left, isn't it? Yeah. So it will shift to the left, and then it will come to a stage where it is parallel to the tangential to the curve, and that is called a critical resistance. So you can have field winding will have one critical resistance above which it will not self-excite at all. Okay, that is can be explained only by this curve. But if you decrease the resistance, it will assume different values and it will have different steady state voltages. Okay, it will be, if you direct resistance, it will be here for a given speed. So it is voltage that generated not only depends upon in a shunt machine, depends upon the speed and also the critical or the resistance of the field circuit. So you can have an extra resistance and you can do this. Pardon? if greater, then there is no interaction, you know, there is no intersection at all. See, you want to have a steady, this is steady operating point. So if it's tangential, it is just the infinite points of touching. Now if it beyond that, there is no point touching this curve at all. Yeah, how much voltage drop will you will end up here, which cannot be measured, maybe a few millivolts may be there. Okay, so if you increase the field resistance, that is why it is called a critical resistance for self excited generators. Okay, now the other characteristic is called a load characteristics. This is, that's open circuit characteristics, this is load characteristics. So let us look at the load characteristics. What are interested? You have a generator which is being driven by a prime mover. You want to know how much the terminal voltage is changing as you load it. Like you are going to increase the load. You change the load from no load. You don't want to operate on no load. If you are operating on no load, you don't buy a generator. Okay? You are buying a generator, you want to supply certain load. And you preferably you would like to load it to the maximum possible extent. Okay. Now, as your load current changes, say as the load current changes, then what will happen? If it is a separately excited system, it will drop. If it is separate, ESC is separately excited. Okay. If it is separately excited system, there is a drop. Why does it drop? Why does the voltage drop? Why do you expect the voltage should drop in a generator? No, in a separately excited, my field current is constant. Yes, yes, current, but current is drawn, then why should the voltage at the terminal decrease? So there is one thing, there is an internal resistance in the armature because of there is an IARA drop. So VT is EA minus IARA. That is one thing which we already have seen it, isn't it? We have an expression for a generator. The voltage is EA minus IARA. So it's simple. Therefore, there is expected to be resistance drop. But beyond which, of course, it is beyond the scope of this lecture, there is another phenomena. As you increase the load, armature is taking more current, then that will also create an MMF. See, earlier it was an ideal field MMF only, just across this. But afterwards, armature is coming. Though armature is supposed to be a magnet which is created at quadrature, there will always be, you know, some components, because it's not such an ideal one, which will try to reduce the main flux also. So that is called a demagnetizing effect. In fact, there is no time to explain all those things in details, but you understand that there is a demagnetizing effect of loading. That is important. There is a demagnetizing effect of loading. Apart from the armature, it will try to have this. Now that means there is a distortion of the magnetic field structure in the air gap due to loading, both along the pole axis and at the armature axis. Now they try to modify this, to nullify this effect along the armature axis by putting what is known as interpoles. Okay, they put some interpoles so that on loading, distortion is somehow compensated. But on main flux, you can't put additional poles as soon as the load comes. So you put up with the drops. Or you adjust the field current. Because there you can't, that means you have to add an MMF on the main axis and quadrature axis on loading to compensate the distortion effects of the armature currents. Quadrature axis, you put interpoles, and main axis, you adjust the field current of the main poles. Then you also try to see, of course, this is again a little higher physical phenomena. This type of distortion also, after all, the the motor, the conductors are going round and round, and it is experiencing different points of B in the air gap when it is rotating. Now, when it sees this type of changes in B and changes in flux linkages, if a coil changes a drastic change in flux linkage, in that coil, especially when it is changing commutation from one brush to another, this is called, there is at any instant there is a coil undergoing commutation. There is always a coil undergoing commutation, and if in that process in the interpolar, that is always in the interpolar region, and the coil undergoing commutation, if it feels a highly distorted MMF, then it leads to sparking, because they are very high voltages are induced because of d phi by dt if due to distortion. So in order to avoid this sparking, you know, DC motor sparking is one of the very important problems where you find any DC motor, you try to brushes go off like this. So in order to avoid the sparking, the so called interpoles also would help to avoid sparking, because it will try to improve the distortions, or nullify the distortions or reduce the distortions. Okay, I mean, these are just a physical way I could explain, because there is no time for further details. So you understand there is a drop in voltage due to demagnetization due of loading. Now obviously, if this is self excited case, then shunt excited will be worse, because in shunt excited voltage across the field winding will not be constant, unlike in a separately excited one. Therefore, there will be further drop in voltage on loading. So that is shunt excited. Now, supposing you have a compound excited but differential, it will be still worse. It is compound excited, but it is differential, means there is a series MMF will go on reducing the shunt MMF on loading. See, it was not there. You see, this point, without loading, all are at the same point. Okay, without loading, all are at the same point. Now, so I hope you understand that cumulative differential compound generator will further result in further drop in voltage. So for any given load, you will see separately excited, shunt excited, and compound excited. Okay, then you have another thing. You go the other way around. You make it cumulatively compound. Then this will be better. So you can almost get a constant voltage with load if you adjust the series MMF in such a way that will almost totally compensate for armature voltage drop and demagnetizing effects. Okay, so this is called a series compensation or a cumulative compound. So this is how you get the four characteristics of a DC generator. Okay, because you can, as we have already said, in a cumulative compound, shunt aids the series, and differential compound, okay, we have seen that in cumulative, shunt aids the series, and differential, series opposes the shunt. Series will be opposing the shunt in differential, but in this case, series winding is aiding this. So net MMF in any compound machine will be NFIF plus or minus NSIS. When is it plus? Cumulative minus when it is differential. I deliberately didn't write it, but anyway, the curve will be something like this. But nobody, you know, series generator is like your dinosaur, you know. Okay.
Sir, in this generator, how do we decide which MMF is going to be both field or series?
Which one? No, shunt is always. Shunt is the main flux, basically. Series is the one which is. Otherwise, if shunt is less, then you are in trouble. Okay. Right. Now, you have also. Now, let us look at the characteristic of DC series motor. That is the generator characteristics. I would rate motor characteristics more important for all of you should know, because the motor is the one which is very much in use. Okay, let us look at the equations. This is the characteristics of motor. The equations are, if it is a shunt motor, center have separately excited are more or less same, you have a constant flux system. Right? Flux is constant. Therefore, you can say that speed is equal to voltage divided by K phi. Right? So it's almost K phi is constant. Or V minus IRA by K phi. The V by K phi minus the current is always proportional to the torque. Current is T by K phi. See, current is T by K phi, isn't it? Therefore, I said TL by K phi square. So, you can write the speed is equal to V by K phi, which is a constant, minus T by K phi square into RA. It's almost like C1 minus C2 TL. So, it's almost like a linear curve, only due to the resistance there is. And we can similarly prove that series system, your flux is proportional to armature current. In a series motor, flux is proportional to armature current, and therefore you can prove that speed is approximately equal to some constant divided by root of T. Okay? Root of T, because it is almost if you neglect V minus, if neglect resistance, it is nearly omega is equal to V by K phi, and phi is proportional to I, which is proportional to root of T. This is just to give you a qualitative explanation of the characteristics. Therefore, you will notice that the current is, that means torque is proportional to current square. Is it okay in a series machine? Our current is proportional to root of T for a series machine, because flux is proportional to current. Okay, with these you can try to, with these relations you can try to get the characteristics like this. In a motor characteristics, what are you interested? You are interested to know, I have a motor, I go on loading it, I would like to see how the speed changes. That is your, just like in the generator, you are loading it electrically and know how much the voltage changes. Here you are interested to know how the speed changes with torque, because your torque is your independent variable and speed is a dependent variable. So motor characteristics will be speed versus torque. Okay, and the therefore the shunt one, as you say, it will be like this, and series will be like this, maybe hyperbolic type. No, this is series. Maybe I like to say series. I mean, SCA. Okay, self excited is same as shunt. Okay, now you will, but if it is compound, interestingly, if it is cumulatively compound, cumulative compound means it will go nearer the series characteristics, because series is become predominant. If it is differentially compound, means it will underflux it, and if you underflux it, means speed increases. Okay? So this is differentially compound, this is cumulatively compound, this is the series. So what you will see is the shunt is nearly a constant speed operation, it is suitable, shunt machine, nearly constant speed operation. But whereas series is not suitable for constant speed operation, for a variable speed operation, but which is a high torque at zero speed. Right? This is one of the important. It has infinite torque at zero speed, infinite speed at zero torque. This means the series motor should not be started on no load. Okay? So that is why it is used for electric traction. You are always starting with passengers on. Okay? It's on load. You are not wanting it to be no load, because you can't ask the passengers to get off on starting and get in as the motor starts. Okay? So this is meant for wherever you require a high starting torque. You know, most of the domestic mixers are AC series motors. They have this type of. So in a drive system, these two have been a well known thing. One is the series characteristic, another is the shunt characteristics. Okay. Right. Okay. Next, as you have seen the characteristics now, next important thing that you would like to know is normally the speed control of DC motor. Okay? we normally, the simple expression you know is speed is equal to Vt minus IRA divided by K phi. That is a known expression, simple. Now that means you can control Vt, you can control RA, or you can control phi. So we have these three methods, control RA, control phi, control Vt. So you can have the any one of the methods to control. Okay. Now the simplest thing is the most original ones when they thought they were controlling through extra resistance. That was the most original. So if you put in extra resistance, that the problem is you are put there, it is having lot of losses. That is the problem. So if you are at reduced speeds, you have increased losses. Therefore, and then it is also sensitive to loads because there is a more drop here. Okay, it becomes sensitive to loads. Though it's a here you are maintaining constant flux. Next is controlling the flux. Now, if you control the flux is one way. That means you change the field current and you control the flux. That is one way of controlling the speed. If you control the flux, the only thing is you will go above base speed. You can't go below the base speed. See, after all, there is certain nominal flux in which you are operating. You can't increase that flux. You can only decrease the flux. That means flux control is always underfluxing, not overfluxing. So that means you can decrease the flux. That means speed will be only above that base speed. You can't control it below the base speed at flux control. Yes, yes, that is it, but your power in the field structure is very negligible compared to armature structure. Okay, the last method, which is also attributable to it's called a Ward-Leonard method. It is Ward-Leonard who invented this method. It has been still used. I mean, one of the longest inventions still under use, I think, is Ward-Leonard method of speed control. And there, voltage is changed. Now, of course, nowadays you have static Ward-Leonard with power electronic devices, so you can have a rectifier. You can control the voltage across the motor armature, and that is being used now. So, controlling the voltage, but if you control the voltage, it will only be below base speed. It is not above base speed. That is important. Now, you can't go above the voltage, rated voltage. You go below the, you can go from zero to voltage. So, these two are, you can say, more or less complementary. If you want to go above base speed, you go for flux control. Below base speed, you go for voltage control. Okay, so this is the three methods of speed control in general, which is used in DC machines. Right. Okay. So if you look at the three, it's easier to explain this way. Below base speed is a resistance control. If it is a resistance control, for different values of resistances, that means you go on increasing the resistance, say R3 is more than R2 is more than R1. So you have the three characteristics like this. Okay? So you have different characteristics, and suppose this is the opposing torque, load torque. See, after all, it is the opposite, this is load characteristics. So motor characteristics and load characteristics will interact to produce this quiescent operating point, isn't it? It is the load characteristics and the motor characteristics. So for different R's, R1 you will have omega 1, R2 you have omega 2, R3 you have omega 3, and these are of course the torques. Maybe you can have T1, T2, T3, right? So you will see that of course this is lossy, and then you have a very no load speed is same, and you have a very marginal change in speed. Okay, and supposing if it is load torque somewhere here, you hardly get any change in speed. So you will notice that change in speed, it is not very sensitive to resistance. You cannot get a large change of speed in a resistance control. And resistance control will be more effective only at high loads. Means it is lossy. So it is used only in very limited cases. Next, let us look at the voltage control. This is the voltage control. This is a V control. In a voltage control, it's always below base speed, as you said. It is below base speed, but it is a constant flux operation. Okay? This is a constant flux operation. That is, but voltage you are changing. And if you want, if this is the same load characteristics, that means, but here you will see here V1, V2, V3, V4, where V4 is less than V3, less than V2, less than V1. Okay. And you will notice that you are able to get, this is W1, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4. What you will notice? With reference to resistance, how do you compare this? You have a much larger speed range. Even if you say there is a low loads also, okay, you will see there is a considerable change in resistance. In fact, if you put V4, suppose ultimately you can even start from 0. See, suppose no load speed can vary from 0 to some base speed. Even the no load speed may vary. So, this is, that way voltage control is versatile, but you must have a variable voltage source. After all, there is nothing like a free lunch. For everything you have to pay. In engineering, unlike in politics, you have to pay for everything. Okay? After all, politicians can give free electricity to farmers. He doesn't lose anything. He gets votes. Okay? But whereas engineers have a problem, it is the electricity board engineer who will have to break his head. How to give free electricity, because there is always, he doesn't have electricity to give. Okay? When somebody has to produce, then he has to fight with the Coal India to get coal. Okay? So, this is the sequence of things. So, this is the role of, a very difficult role of an engineer, that he has to make a sort of populist slogans implementable. Now, you see here, you need to have a voltage source. So, you must have another machine or equipment which will give you a variable DC voltage. So, that means it's an equivalent investment on that money. Whereas, resistance control, you can say, you just put a rheostat and go on varying this. So, you have done this. So, that is why resistance control people may still use it. After all, why do you use a resistance control in fans, for example? Fan regulator is simple. You have a resistance control over there, like that. Of course, that's the AC machine. So, this is the changes here. Okay. Now, but it is a constant flux machine and it is below base speed. And if it is operating at constant current, it can also operate at constant torque, because flux is constant. At all speeds, if you maintain the current constant, supposing at all speeds you maintain the current constant by adjusting the load, so this is suitable for a constant torque drive. Right? So, this is a constant torque drive. Because at all speeds, flux is constant. And if you maintain the current constant at all speeds, you can always go up to the capacity. That means you can load it up to a rated torque at all speeds. So, it is suitable for constant torque drive at all speeds. Okay? So, there are some sort of applications where you require constant torque at all speeds, then it is more suitable. Okay? Increasing the voltage, yes. If it is a 230 volts machine, you can't put 400 volts across it. Isn't it? It is wound for 230 volts.
But it has got some rated speed. We can increase it above the rated
speed. No, rated speed. Speed can go to 10,000 RPM. I'm not talking. Voltage can't go up. Voltage is 230 volts machine, should be 230 volts rated. You can go below that. Otherwise, your insulation levels, everything will go up. Isn't it? Okay. Now, lastly, the flux control. The flux control, you have again it goes above the base speed, so you if phi1 is a nominal flux, you under flux it. That way less than that, phi2, phi3, phi4 is under fluxing, phi2 is less, phi3 is less, phi4 is less. So under fluxing it, so it goes to above base speed, again you can have these speeds omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4, and this is a flux control. In this flux control, voltage is constant, right? in this flux control, voltage is constant, and if your current is constant, voltage is constant, current is constant, therefore here power is constant, not torque. Because voltage is constant and current is constant at all speeds. If you go to the rated speed, okay? So we can, wherever you want, whatever the speed range, accordingly you choose the method. Okay. Then another thing which you have learnt or in the laboratory is how to start a motor. Okay. Speed controller, starting of DC motor. At start, this is the next thing. So at start, you know the speed is 0 and EA is 0. Therefore, IA is VT by RA, which is very high. Okay. So the current has to be limited at starting. Right. But if you limit, but torque is proportional to K5 IA. So even if it's a phi is constant, torque is proportional to current. If you limit the current, you should not limit to such an extent it won't start. Okay. So you need a good starting torque. So we need good starting torque and a low starting current at start. T must be good, current must be low. Not about that. So therefore, what we do is we add resistance at start. Usually, that's how you start DC motors. Is you add resistance in the armature circuit at start. So there are standard starters, which does the job, and that means it reduces reduce that resistance as speed increases. So you cut off the resistance. So this is one of the methods of starting. Okay, or other way is you apply low voltage. You have a variable voltage system. You apply low voltage and at start you apply a low voltage and increase to rated volt value at this thing, at rated speed. So two methods of starting. Resistance starting, you put extra resistance and cut off, or a voltage starting, you apply a low voltage and increase the to the nominal value. Is it okay? So these are the methods of starting. Voltage starting and resistance starting. And if you have too many number of start stops, resistance starting means it will be having a problem of losses, etc. Because you pay for losses. So last is this. Okay, where do you use these DC motors? Application of DC motors. Permanent magnet motors. This is again which is coming up. I think the coming period is going to be permanent magnet motors, large numbers. They are used in entertainment electronics, all your videos, tape recorders and so on. They all use permanent magnet DC motors. They are operated by DC source from within the circuit. They are used in toys. They are used in robotics. They are used in CNC machine tools, computer numerical control machine tools. They are used now in PV operated motor pumps, because all the PV photovoltaics are DC, and they found it is that is permanent magnet. They are used in all the space applications. That in space applications, the supply is from PV panels, so they use the permanent magnet machines and all the computer drives. So these are typical application of permanent magnet DC motors. Okay. And as far as the shunt machines are concerned, the typical applications, and what did we learn about shunt machines? That it should be nearly constant speed and it has versatility of speed control by voltage control and flux control. So they are used in all the steel rolling mills, steel mill drives. They are used in mining applications of mainly coal mining, where you can control the speed of taking out the coal, lifting and all that thing. And then they are used in textiles, wherever there is a variable speed operations, and good number of textile motors are DC motors. Okay. Then they are used in some of the machine tool applications where the variable speed is required. And that means general adjustable speed drives. Wherever there is speed is to be adjusted, DC shunt motors are still being used because they are versatility of speed control. They are used in paper mill drives. They are also used in some of the chemical plants and also in some of the sugar mills drives. So this is the shunt machines wherever you have a variable speed operation. Then the series motors. series motors find main application in electric traction. Even today, all the electric trains running in India are series motors. Okay, and the electric vehicles, electric cars, which they are still being thought of as DC series motors, and there are DC series motors used in cranes, where you require high starting torque. They are used in hoists or lifts, you know, excavators, and they are used in factory forklift trucks. I don't know whether you have seen forklift trucks.
Yes, sir.
Huh? No, sir. No? Yes, somebody has seen forklift trucks. You know, in the factory it just lifts everything. They are called forklift trucks. They are all using DC series motors. So this is just a general view of a DC machines, and you can get the copies made and use it. Okay.